that the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I?
Welcome to Who Am I? With Pastor Greg Tyra of Harvest Chapel in Williamsport, Indiana. We're glad you could join us as we teach through the Bible, chapter by chapter, verse by verse. Today's lesson is one in which we know you'll be enlightened to the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's listen in to Pastor Greg as we launch today's lesson on Who Am I?
Turning your Bibles with me to John chapter 10. We're going to be beginning in verse 1 this morning. Now, if you'll remember with me, Jesus, in chapter 9, healed a man blind from birth. And he has taken this man and used him as an illustration. He's used him as a picture to you and I of leading someone all the way to himself. And this is what we need. We need people to come to Jesus. If I be lifted up, I will draw all men to myself, Jesus has said. For this purpose I have come, Jesus has said. And now we're going to see that he leads him all the way to what? The Good Shepherd. And that's what John chapter 10, the first 30 verses really are about, is the Good Shepherd. And we need to understand that because we've been given bad shepherds. You know, Jesus planted a field and the enemy, while it was dark, came out and sowed tares. And he's really destroyed the kingdom of God if you look at it with a physical eyes. But in a spiritual eyes and in a spiritual sense, Jesus already knew what was going to happen. God already knows all of this. And he still gives his sheep eyes to see and ears to hear what he would say to the church. And that's why it's so important that we stand up and stand out. And don't shut up, but we speak up because we know the truth. We know who the truth is. It's Jesus the Christ. And so now as we closed out last week, in the end, he met this blind man that was blind from birth. And then what did he do at last? He opened his spiritual eyes because he says, do you believe in the Son of Man? Do you believe in the Son of God? And he said, who is he, Lord, that I might believe him? That's 36. And Jesus said, you have both seen him, and it is he who you are talking with. Are you talking with Jesus? Are your spiritual eyes open and you're not talking with Jesus? You're not in prayer? You're not learning to articulate and learn his voice so that you can be one of his sheep in his fold? So you can hear his voice and follow him and understand that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. If God tells you to do something, you get out of the boat and you go do it. You get to see the evidence of walking by faith as he comes through and does it. But if God tells you to do something and you get out of the boat and you don't do it, then your faith doesn't grow. You don't get to see God come through because you've silenced God. You put your hand in his face and you say, nope. Talk to the hand. I'm the authority here. Listen, God is talking to this man, leading him to himself. He led him all the way to himself to come to know him. And now he wants him to follow him. What does this man do? He says, Lord, I believe. Verse 38. Pistio, I trust. I commit myself to you. I entrust my spiritual well-being into you. You're the Messiah. He believes him. And then he worshiped him. He bowed down to him. He gave up his will to him. He bowed completely down to God's will. And it's God's will that none would perish, but all would come to repentance. They would change their mind and stop going in one direction, which is away from God, and they would turn and follow God. But there's those that are listening, and they hear, and I'm skipping over some verses here. They're listening, the Pharisees, the separatists, those that are the teachers, if you're keeping with the theme, listen, there's no break in between these chapters. This is all one scroll as it was written. And we have breaks so I can tell you to turn to chapter 10. I can tell you to turn to chapter 10, verse 16. I can tell you where to go and you can know where I'm at. But those were added later. And none of these breaks are here. So the conversation continues. So make sure you remember that as we go through it. That's why I read 1 through 10 last week. I think I read 1 through 10. In the context of what it was. Because they said, when they heard his words, verse 40b, are we blind also? And how did Jesus answer them? Now get, remember, they're the leaders. They think they're the shepherds. They think they are leading people to God. And Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no sin. But now you say, we see, therefore your sin remains. Listen, their sin, really, he's speaking of here mainly is the sin of unbelief. God had told him he's going to send a Messiah. They're telling everybody the Messiah's coming. They're telling everybody how to live, and they're false shepherds, they're lost shepherds, and they're blind. Their sin of unbelief because they will not believe that God keeps his promises. They do not believe that Jesus is God, and everything that Jesus does is clearly to show that I am. That's what he's trying to show them, that he is the great I am, the self-existing one. He makes clay. They hear it. They understand it. And they say no because it doesn't line up with what we're doing. Listen to me. I think we're in great fear in the church today of doing the same thing that they've done. We've been handed a system. See, these people quite naturally did not create the system. But they keep repeating the system that is so far away from God that it has nothing to do with God. And they keep repeating it and handing it on because they refuse to listen to the Word of God and the Spirit of God and be drawn near to God and be taught by God. And so as Jesus begins to talk about the Good Shepherd, you're going to see that the Old Testament is riddled with shepherds. See, because they were sheep herders. They were flocks. You know, we're going to see that first of all, Jesus, he says that they will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. That this has to happen first. All of these things are going on as we open up the text and we see that these shepherds, and we'll get into it more next week as we go into Ezekiel 34 and a couple places where we really need to see that the shepherds have walked away from God and made up their own little rules, their own little religion, their own little dress codes, their own little interpretations of the law. And it's the same thing we're doing in the church today. And then we hand it down. And then if the other people, they go back to the Word of God and they ignore your traditional teaching, then they're the bad guys. Just like they crucified Jesus, they want to crucify you for saying, go to the Word of God. But see, when we put self on the throne, when we put self on the throne and we want to be the decider of who the shepherd is, we want to be the shepherd of our own life. Don't judge me, man. I'm the boss of mine. I'm the one doing this here. Listen, if you don't make the Word of God your shepherd, we're going to see in a minute, he's not just the door. He is the shepherd of the sheep. He is the door. He's the way in. He's the way out of this world. We need to listen to the Word of God. And we need to follow his authority structure, not our own. And when we follow self, what do? We raise up shepherds that tickle our ears. We raise up shepherds that teach physical. We raise up shepherds that teach things that are not true. They're politically correct, but they walk away from the scriptures. They water it down. They make it fit so that I can keep walking around and doing exactly what I want to do, but everybody else is messed up. And we actually, in ourself, lead ourselves straight to hell. We make a choice that I do not want the light of the world to lead me. I do not want to be in fellowship with him. I like what I'm doing. And we reject. And we stay in unbelief. We don't grow in our faith because we don't put our faith and our trust in the Word of God. Listen, all of that's leaving sin out. Sin has been dealt with at the cross. Quit looking at people and saying, sinners. If you're in the church, sin is dealt with. Who are you going to follow is the question. Because you can't follow Jesus and stay in sin. If you follow Jesus, then the power of sin will be gone. You'll be in life. Listen, The penalty's been paid for. You want to lose the power? Begin following the light of the world. Begin obeying. Begin walking in righteousness, being led by the good shepherd, the great shepherd, the chief shepherd of the sheep. See, because all that was before him are thieves and robbers. And they butchered the word of God. They butchered the relationship with God. They used it to be in power and control of people instead of presenting you to God. All we're supposed to be doing is presenting people to God, saying, be reconciled to God. Be reconciled to God. And if they're reconciled to God, they'll become a disciple of God. How can you meet the Lord of glory and not want to follow him? How can you meet the Lord of glory and not want to be like him? How can you recognize your own sinful, evil flesh and not surrender it? Unless it's your own self-will. You want to shepherd your own life. I'm going to go to a church that teaches the way I like. Listen, you want Jesus to purify you. You want him to wash and cleanse you. You want him to confront you in your sin. Because if not, you may not be saved. If you're able to stay in your sin, live in your sin, be in your sin, and you don't understand the gospel, I'm not saying stumble. A lot of us stumble. All of us stumble, I should say. Not a lot. We fall down. But you know, one day we're going to lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. Because it's all because of him that we're able to even be here. Listen, so these blind guides, if the blind lead the blind, they both end up in the ditch. They find one proselyte, that's somebody that they want to tell about God, and they make them twice the sons of hell. Why? Because they're not using the word of God with the spirit of God, bringing them to God. They want to bring them to their system. They want to bring them to Harvest Chapel. They want to bring them to whatever church you go to instead of bring them to Jesus. And anytime you add something else to the gospel, anytime you say this is what we're doing, anytime other than the reconciliation of souls, you add something to it, you are in danger of becoming a thief and a robber. Because you're stealing the true, pure, simple gospel away from Jesus, who is there with his spirit, convicting of sin and righteousness and judgment. So when we start adding some other stuff to it, you can become like these blind guides. Eventually, you begin to build your structure, your rules, your system, and now they have to walk like this and do like this and be like this, and you end up with an apostate church. You have people that are called out from the world, but they're not called to Jesus. And it's apostasy. You have a form of godliness that rejects the power, which is the word of God. God sent his word to heal the land. And what did the word do? He came and took flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And then what did he do? He died on a cross and rose again and asked the Father to send back the Spirit so that he could live in our hearts and be the porter. That's what's going to happen as we get into this. Let's get into this a little bit and look at it. But basically, they're blind. They think they can see. They think they're okay, and they're pointing out everybody else's sin, but they're blind. And they've missed God. And they're trying to lead people to God when they don't even have a relationship with God. Listen, point them to Jesus. If not, you're in danger of lifting up your heel against him. You're either going to lift up Jesus or you're going to lift up your heel. Listen to me, we got to wake up to this. But we can't just keep doing what we do. I'm saved, I'm doing what I'm doing. Listen to me, we can't act like it's only the preachers, it's only the Bible study leaders, it's the body of Christ. I'm going to preach the same message every single Sunday because it's all of us together. But we've been handed an apostate system just like they have, and Jesus is standing before them, and they're so blind they can't see the truth there with them. And he goes on to bring accusation against them and say that you're the blind shepherds. You're the shepherds of unbelief leading people to hell, and I'm the good shepherd. And he's going to say why? Because he's willing to lay down his life for the sheep. And if we're following Jesus, we should be willing to lay down our life for others. We should be able to get off of our thrones, our selfishness, and say, I got that. I'll do that. I'll get this. Lord, send me to do that. What am I called to be as a steward, as a servant in your kingdom? Because souls are the only thing that matters anymore. You won't do it perfectly, but we better get in line to start doing it, because that's the plumb line, is to begin to be like Jesus. And the more we see the evidence of that in our lives, then we have assurance of our salvation. There is no assurance if the Spirit of God is not leading our life. I don't care what an apostate system has told people. The Bible's very clear. My sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. That's a clear sign of what we're doing in our lives and where we're following and who we're following and where we're going and what is going on in our hearts. What is motivating your life? What is leading your life? Who is on the throne of your life? Because you could be a blind guide leading blind leaders and think you're okay when you're not. Listen to me. We need to know this before our physical body dies. Because it's appointed for man to die once, and then comes that judgment. We need to know that it's not works. I better make this disclaimer really quick, because some people will go, well, he just said that I need to. No. No, no, no. I said you believe in Jesus just like this man, but then you bow down and you begin to worship. And if you do bow down and you truly believe, there will be evidence. There will be an afterglow in your life that looks like the Shekinah glory of God that begins to grow in your life because of the Spirit of God, through the Word of God, because of the precious blood of Christ that has purchased us. There's going to be evidence in this courtroom that something has changed, that you've met the Lord of glory, and now you're going to stop walking in darkness and start walking in light. Yes, it starts with believing and receiving. But then as an act of your will, you have to bow down. Not for salvation, but because of salvation. I looked this up here a minute ago. I was thinking, and it's Proverbs 28:2. Because of the transgression of a land, many are its princes. Many leaders everywhere. False shepherds. Many princes because of the transgressions of this land. But here's the contrast. A lot of Proverbs are written in parallelisms where they reinforce or they contrast the previous line. But by a man of understanding and knowledge, right will be prolonged. Listen, the church is supposed to be the restraining power right now because of the Holy Spirit in us. And we have the man of understanding, Christ, who come and died for us. But then when his Spirit lives in us, he gives us understanding of what he's doing. And he asks us to get involved. And we go out and tell others. And the man of understanding, we have right prolonged in the society. Right prolonged in our sphere of influence. And right is capitalized in the text. Because it's really righteousness. Right means right living before God. A heart that wants to be led by the Spirit and do what is right before God so that other people can see that there's a true and living God and they will want to know who he is and come to see him and then come to believe in him and then worship him in spirit and truth. So, their unbelief keeps them blind, or they could believe. Listen, the whole Old Testament, the saints look forward. The ecclesia look forward. The people of God look forward. Israel looked forward to the coming Messiah. And they believed by faith that God was going to provide a sacrifice. And how sad is it when he comes and they're so blind that they become the hands and feet that deliver him to Rome so that he can be crucified. Now make no mistake, nobody crucified Jesus. He died for us. He came for this purpose. This is why he came. But the actions of the people that are apostate delivered him to Rome, to a system that killed the worst criminals by hanging them on a tree. Crucifixion. So, verse 1 of chapter 10. Now think about this for a minute. I've got to stop for a second. Notice in chapter 8, woman caught in adultery, Jesus says to her, "Where are your condemners? Neither do I condemn you. Go sin no more." Notice these false shepherds that are in unbelief. What do they end up doing? They're picking up stones to throw them at Jesus. Then what happens? Then Jesus heals a blind man from birth, right? And then what happens? They cast him out. They cast him out of the synagogue because he's trying to tell them that Jesus is the Messiah, that he has to be from God, and they're looking for somebody from God. And then he tells them at the last line, "Therefore your sin remains." He didn't tell them to go and sin no more. He said, "Their sin remains. I'm not condemning you either, but now your sin remains because you will not believe that I am he." And no break. Listen, your sin remains most assuredly, or verily, verily, he would say. Is that what it is? Verily, verily, King James. "I say unto you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the doorkeeper opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls out his own sheep by name and leads them out. And when he brings out his own sheep, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. Yet they will by no means follow a stranger, but will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers." Jesus used this illustration, but they did not understand the things which he spoke to them. Then Jesus said to them again, "Most assuredly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep, and all whoever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep, but a hireling, he who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. The hireling flees because he is a hireling and does not care about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep and am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Therefore my Father loves me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father." And of course, "Therefore there was a division again among the Jews because of these sayings, and many of them said, 'He has a demon and is mad. Why do you listen to him?' Others said, 'These are not the words of one who has a demon. Can a demon open the eyes of the blind?'" So notice again, we're still in the same context, same people, same place. We're still looking at the eyes being open and whether we're blind or whether we can see. See, because if you're still blind and you're looking for somebody to lead you and you follow some blind guides, some blind shepherds, some people that don't know the scriptures and they alter it to make it fit, make it pleasing, to make you come into the building, to make you want to feel all warm and cozy and have some emotions that make you feel like you're part of the family instead of really being part of the family, that's a thief and a robber that's stealing your soul from you. That's a blind guide. It's a liar. We want to meet the truth even when it hurts. Because if we're true Christians, if we're truly the children of God, then He is burning out the dross. That's part of the sanctification process. And we want Him to change us from glory to glory. We want Him to reveal to us those things that are still in our lives, in our hearts. And we want His power to deal with that sin as we follow Him, the light of the world. In fact, it's a light, but it's also a fire. And as you listen to it and you obey, it burns out the dross in your life. And you go further and further in the path, onward and upward, in and out, finding pastor, doing the ministry. And you can do it safely without fear because Christ is with us. So I didn't read 1 through 30, but really 1 through 30 is the culmination of that. We're going to deal with about 10 verses today, but I read some others for context to help us. I think it's sometimes best to read them in context. So let's look back at 10:1. As we see this clear contrast between these blind guides, as we see this clear contrast between these that are in unbelief, and then Jesus presents Himself clearly to them as the Good Shepherd. And see, they would know this. I'm not going to go to Ezekiel 34 until next week, but you can read that as homework. Jeremiah 3 and 4, you can read it as homework. There's plenty of places that this is alluded to in the Old Testament where God has already called out the false teachers. And so He does this constantly. He wants to do it in our life. He wants to do it in our churches. He wants to do it in our, whatever you're listening to on the AI. He wants you to know what a true teacher looks like. It's somebody that's laying down their life. That's why it's relationships. It's not just I'm listening to this person who is echoing something that he knows, and you don't even know what he's really doing, who he's hanging out with. You don't know his association. You don't know his life. That's why God has little bodies of Christ, little sheepfolds everywhere. And that's alluding to 16, because the sheepfold at this time, as he is reading and as we're looking at it, as he's presenting it, the sheepfold is only the nation of Israel. Listen, it's only the nation of Israel at this moment. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. Now, what's he saying to them? And he's saying in the illustration, they don't understand it. Why? Because their eyes are blind. Because they don't have the Spirit of God. They're not looking to do the will of God. They're looking to keep their own power and their pomp and their prestige. And they're looking to block everybody out if they're not doing what they're doing. But the fact is they're blind and they're not doing what God was doing. So Jesus comes and he tells them this, and he's telling you and me this, that if you come any other way except through the door, you're not the shepherd. You're not a true shepherd. But he's saying he is the shepherd. Why? Because he come. He's fulfilling prophecy. Blind eyes are being opened. Deaf are hearing. He was born of a virgin birth. He come. Everything that he does is according to prophecy. Everything that he does is according to the Father. Everything that he does is because he was sent. Everything he does is because he was anointed. Everything he does is led by the Holy Spirit. Everything that he's doing means that he's coming through the door. Listen, it's very important that we understand this. So he really becomes the shepherd, but he's also the door. Because he's God, very God. He's fulfilling prophecies. Some 315 prophecies he fulfills. And they're trying to enter some other way. Let me see if I can find some words here. I like words. Enter, of course, is arise. It means to enter, literally or figuratively, but it means to arise. But listen to what it means. It means to go or to come in, through. And I like that, because that's where we're going to get. Once we come to Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit and we become part of the flock, we're called to go in and out. Verse 9. Freely, safely, with rest, with peace. I was going to start a ministry years ago called the In-N-Out. In California, they got the In-N-Out burgers. Over here, we got McDonald's, but there they got the In-N-Out burgers, and they're actually really good. I've ate them before. But I was always going to do a ministry called the In-N-Out because of this verse. And because of that's what we're supposed to do. Be in Christ and go out and tell others about Christ. So it's the In-N-Out ministry of reconciliation of souls. But I'm not going to start no ministry, because why would I start a ministry when God's already started a ministry and the only one that we need, the ministry of reconciliation. And it's called the church. It's called the sheep coming and being found because of the Holy Spirit. And then they all come into one fold. Verse 16, he says, I have sheep of another flock, and they all have one shepherd. So everybody comes in, and he's the shepherd, we're going to see in a minute. But right now, he's just coming. Well, we're seeing it right now. He comes as the shepherd. And where is he coming? Let me tell you what's going on. Because you have to go and allude to their culture. Because he's speaking to them in words that they know because of their culture. Now, I can explain this in a little way. What they have was what's called city sheepfolds. Plenty of shepherds. If you remember back when they went down to Egypt, pharaohs and them hated. They despised shepherds, but that's what they did. They were people who tended animals. But in the city, there's what's called city sheepfolds. And the only way I can explain this to you is about what I see all the time. If you see a house that's been raised and the foundation is still there, like you got a 4-foot wall all the way around and there's one doorway. And that's what a city sheepfold looked like. But it would be rocks all piled up. It's a perfect place where all the sheep would be pinned in there. And what happened is the shepherds would go out with their sheep and they would lead them around. And we're going to see in a minute, I'll show you a good shepherd. You'd lead them around and you find good green pasture for them. You find waters that are still so that they can stick their head in and drink and not get carried away by the monsoons and the water moving too fast by every wind of doctrine. And so, and then when it would start to get a little dark, they would bring them back into the city. And they would go to what was called a city sheepfold. And there would be a porter there. Here it's called a doorkeeper. It's a porter. And they would say, hey, John, how you doing tonight? Here's my sheep. Take care of them until morning. I'm going to go get some Z's. I'll be back. That's our vernacular. And they would leave them there. And you would have all of these sheep in there, like from 6, 8, 10 different shepherds. They're all in the same place together. Right? Mingling. The marketplace, if you will, as we as sheep. And then in the morning, he'd come out and go, hey, Joe, punching the time clock. And he'd punch the time clock and he'd go. And as soon as his sheep heard his voice, they would separate from the rest of the flocks. And they would come over to the door where the doorkeeper would let him step up and lead his sheep out. And they would follow him wherever he went because they knew that he was going to provide perfectly for them. They knew from experience of walking with them daily and building a relationship that he was going to take care of them. And my God will supply for all of your needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. But you have to be following the true shepherd. You can't blame everything and shame everything and game everything and pretend everything and say, what's going on? God doesn't love me. My shepherd's not good. No, you're not listening to the shepherd's voice. You're doing what you want to do, making up your own type of religion. You're following your own leaders. And we're in danger of hurting other people's lives when we do that. Instead of encouraging people to have a personal love relationship with the shepherd, to get in the word, prayer, and fellowship, to articulate his voice and be led by the Spirit of God, which is what we should do. Because all we are under rowers, or we're shepherds with a small s that try to help people. That's why Paul said, follow me while I follow Jesus. But make sure you're following Jesus, because that was Paul's heart. He was following Jesus. And he didn't want anybody to follow him. He said, if an angel of light or anybody else comes to you with a different gospel, let them be cursed, anathema. He said, if we or an angel of light, anyone comes with a different gospel. And yet we put up with it. He says, who has bewitched you so soon? Foolish Galatians. Yet the church puts up with it. Listen to me. You're not going to be able to get to the throne. I'm not going to be able to get to the throne. And look into his eyes and go, well, one of the shepherds told me. Which can mean pastor anyway, by the way. one of the leaders, one of the elders, one of the blind guides told me, and so I was listening to him. And he's like, my sheep hear my voice. Was you listening for my voice? It's got a distinct sound. It's always truth. It's got a distinct look. It's always light. Never darkness. Was you listening for that? Or was you trying to please your own dark heart? Listen, it's so important that we understand that you cannot go in or come out any other way. And so what happens first? Christ comes to prove that he is the shepherd. Once he comes, now he can prove, I can lead you where you're supposed to go. I know all truth because I am truth. So what's he talking about? I'm following the word of God, the truth of God, what's always been said about God. I came down to become your kinsman redeemer because you have lost your inheritance in the first false shepherd, Adam, who didn't protect his bride. He becomes the first. He's a prophet, yes, but he became a bad prophet because he didn't do what he was supposed to do. I'm not picking on Adam. I don't want to have to fight with him at fisticuffs when we get to heaven. That's not my point. But because of Adam's, we are all confined under sin. Because none of us can properly present Jesus perfectly. But the Holy Spirit can. Listen, the Holy Spirit can. That's why he's here. Convicted of sin and righteousness and judgment. I think it's very interesting that, you know where the first mention of door is? See, because the law of first mention is a great place to look when you're talking about things. The first mention of door is in Genesis 4, 6, and 7, where God is chastising Cain, saying, why are you so downcast? Why are you so angry in your countenance? If you do well, it'll be good for you. But if not, sin is crouching at your door. That's the first usage. Because see, if we'll listen to the light of the word, if we'll follow the good shepherd, if we'll listen to what God is saying in his truth, and our hearts are surrendered, even when we mess up, he's already paid for all of our sin. But if we don't, and we follow false shepherds, lying shepherds, follow the desires of our own heart, then what happens? Sin is crouching at our door. And its desire is to rule over you. But you're supposed to rule over it by choice, by choosing to be led by the Spirit. Because as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the children of God. The Spirit's never going to lead us into darkness. The Spirit's never going to lead us into any other door except for Jesus. And the Spirit knows who the porter is. And that's what we're seeing here. Jesus fulfills Scripture. He becomes flesh and blood. And as flesh and blood, now he can be our kinsman. He's flesh like us. God took on flesh. He became flesh. He pitched his tent among us. Right? So now he's able. Now he first has to live a perfect life. Now that he's kinsman, he can live a perfect life. Anybody that lives a perfect life according to the law can redeem you. If you live a perfect life according to the law, you don't need a redeemer. But nobody can. Because of our sin nature. Jesus didn't have Adam as a father. He had the Father in heaven as his father. So he didn't inherit the sin nature that you and I have. So he was able to be tempted in all things and yet without sin. He's able to aid those who are tempted and come to our help and protect us. And so he comes now with this perfect life, perfect blood, perfect sacrifice, perfect love. He's got a perfect offering before God, and God receives it. And if you'll believe that in your heart and confess it with your mouth, you shall be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. See, the evidence is you're walking it out. Here's the evidence. I'm confessing it. I'm agreeing. I know it. I'm learning. I'm becoming relational with it. And here I go. Here's my salvation lived out in front of you. And I can show you my faith by my works. Not perfect works, but I'm endeavoring to do what Christ called us to do. Finding out what the will of the Lord is, walking circumspectly in it, confessing our sins daily. So now it's perfect blood. And he makes a perfect sacrifice for us. He becomes the shepherd because he's following what the door said. what the Father said, who opened the door and anointed him to come as the Mashiach of God, the Messiah of God, the anointed, the Christ. And he's presenting his resume, if you will, to these blind teachers who are not going to understand because they're so far away from God, they have no spiritual eyes to understand that he's saying, I'm fulfilling Scripture as we stand here. That makes me the shepherd, and the porter is going to let me in. Who's the porter? The Holy Spirit. It's the Spirit that hovered over the water. It's the Spirit. God is Spirit. So we'll see that the porter, the doorkeeper, is really the Spirit of God. So now we have the whole world. This is really the nation of Israel, but the sheepfold becomes bigger. It becomes the whole world. And when Jesus comes, the Holy Spirit is sent into the world to convict of sin and righteousness and judgment. We'll get to that. It's chapter 16. And he convicts everybody of sin and righteousness and judgment. And if you hear that voice and you confess and believe in Jesus, then he comes and lives in your heart. And then you're free to go in and out. You come in, you're in Jesus, you come to hear, and you go out to tell others because you're a sheep and his pasture, and you want others to come and be reconciled to God. And you become ministers of reconciliation. This is what the simple gospel is, yet we've been handed in many ways apostasy. We've been handed a false gospel that talks about dress clothes, that talks about people that we don't want them in here, that talks about psychology, that talks about everything in the world except for surrendering, believing, and worshiping God. And when you do, a life changes. So Jesus says, if you come in any other way, enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. Anybody that comes with any other gospel is a part of a thief and a robber. They're part of Antichrist's system. They're part of what the devil is doing. If a person is not teaching you the Word of God, if it doesn't line up with the Word of God, we're going to see in a minute that his true sheep will flee. That's why I tell you all the time, if you're sitting in Andy Stanley's church and you're not flipping over chairs and getting out of there, then you're not his sheep. I feel terrible for the Branch Davidians and all the people that died down there with David Koresh. And you can go, look what the government did. No, look what the devil did. Look what they did. They didn't believe the truth. They wouldn't listen to the truth. And they died. Everybody's going to die that doesn't listen to truth. It's very sad. I'm not picking on anybody. But they had the truth before them. And the Bible says nowhere that here we're going to build this, we're going to store up some guns, and all you women sleep upstairs with me, and you men stay downstairs and guard the fort. I'll take care of the women. I mean, if you have the truth before you, you should know what darkness looks like. And he says right here that they'll in no way follow a stranger, but they'll flee when he comes. And there's people that would give testimony that they fled from the Branch Davidians because it wasn't true. It's only a step off of, what was it, Jehovah's Witnesses? I think that's where it came from. Originally, the lady that came out of the Jehovah's Witnesses and started some movement, and then the Davidians. I'm sorry, off base. Let's get back. Because Jesus is proving that he is the shepherd. He's the one that takes care of. Listen what shepherd means.
Today's lesson is those, on who am I?
Especially sheep. So in other words, you're not supposed to be going backwards. You're never supposed to go backwards. Sheep don't go backward. They always go forward. They're always following the shepherd, being led. Here we herd cattle here in America. In the West, we herd everything. Over there, they still lead sheep out. They still lead them. They don't hurt them. Sometimes they use dogs too, like we do, but they lead them. And there's a relationship. They still lead them out. What was I looking for? Yeah, we're going. So Jesus is the shepherd. He comes to the door. The door is a portal or entrance or opening. He comes to the door. Talking of city sheepfolds, there's a guy standing there, which is the Holy Spirit in this guest, the doorkeeper. But right now, what is it? Revelation 3:20. Jesus, a gentleman, never with force, truth knocking at the door, light of the world knocking at the door. Revelation 3:20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hear my voice and open the door, invite him in. He's inviting us by knocking to come into heaven. He's the way out of this world, the way out of your death, the way out of your sin nature, to be delivered from the sin nature, and the way into heaven. How do we get to heaven if we don't follow him? Oh, I believe in Jesus. Are you following him? Where's he at? Do you know him? Where's he going? What's he doing? What's your relationship with him? Where's he seated at? See, these are questions. How do I get there? I could be following a blind leader. I could be following something that tickles my ears instead of following the true shepherd of the sheep.
We hope you enjoyed part one of a two-part message. Please join us here next week for part two. And that concludes today's message on Who Am I? With Pastor Greg Tyra of Harvest Chapel in Williamsport, Indiana. If you're in the area, we would love to have you as our guest. Harvest Chapel is located at 418 Old State Road 28, Williamsport, Indiana, 47993. We meet for worship on Sundays at 10 a.m. Our prayer meetings meet Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m. Our Bible study meets on Friday at 7 p.m. Today's and previous messages are available on CD. If you would like a copy, please call 765-404-7203. We look forward to seeing you again next time on Who Am I?
Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? 'Cause I